Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Unlocked Leader. Dare to free your own voice, lead with empathy, and shine your light in the world. By Hortense le Gentil, narrated by Nikki Zakocs. Limit of Liability Disclaimer of Warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Further, readers should be aware that websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Neither the publisher nor authors shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including, but not limited to, special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Foreword. For the past 35-plus years, I've watched Hortense le Gentil flout conventional wisdom and take risks to stay true not only to herself and her values, but also to her unflinching aspiration to help others reach their utmost potential. These are the very qualities that have made her a preeminent CEO and executive coach. So I read The Unlocked Leader, knowing that it would be a powerful book for listeners and leaders on a professional level. And it certainly achieves that objective. For me personally, reading this book has been profound, helping me make sense of a life-changing experience that has been both unbearably sad and magnificently uplifting. Hortense's approach of helping unlock the human leader in all of us by identifying and confronting mind traps in order to move to mind shifts and finally to a mind build was just what the proverbial doctor ordered for me, based on what unfolded in my life over the past 18 months. She writes about the power of letting go, which, of course, sounds good in theory, but makes any skeptical person wonder whether it actually works or will help you achieve your goals. And even if you do believe it could work, it is truly scary to release yourself from the beliefs you've grown up with that are core to who you are and that have led you to the success you've garnered up to this point in time. I experienced the power of the unlocked leader in the most real and sad way possible. But I had no choice. And what I learned was to become the silver lining to a very dark cloud in my life. For more than 25 years, I have been a partner at Spencer Stuart, one of the world's preeminent executive recruitment and leadership advisory firms, where I lead our CEO practice. I've had the privilege of helping clients with more than 800 CEO searches and successions, as well as board director and C-suite appointments for some of the world's best-known and most successful organizations. I've always taken pride in being fully responsive to clients, colleagues, and candidates, working long hours in a very hands-on way. This was based on the conviction that when clients retained our firm, with me as the team lead, I had to personally drive everything. Some of our competitors have senior partners bring in the business as rainmakers, only to pass off the project to more junior professionals to do the work. That was never the Spencer Stuart ethos. We take pride in doing the work. This all changed when disaster struck. In late 2021, my beloved wife, Lindsay, became sick and was diagnosed with a devastating and rare form of cancer. We were living in London, and she was on the world's most advanced clinical trial for her form of cancer. I continued to serve clients remotely while taking Lindsay to chemotherapy and immunotherapy sessions at University College London, to GI specialists at the London Clinic and the Cleveland Clinic London, and eventually to Royal Trinity Hospice. It quickly became clear that I had no alternative but to let go. I literally could not do or drive every aspect of work as I had done for so many years. I also followed other aspects of Hortense's wise advice in this book: to be transparent, to be open and vulnerable, and, more than anything else, to be human. Often, I did Zoom meetings from the treatment locations, during which I always explained where I was and what was going on. What transpired were three unexpected things that I will never forget, that show the profound lessons of the unlocked leader. First, not surprisingly, I was emotionally supported in my time of need. I was surrounded by love and trust by clients, colleagues, and candidates. Everyone understood what we were dealing with and going through, and where I was doing my calls from. Work went from vocation to avocation, and it became a source of strength and joy that helped me cope and therefore be the best carer I could be for Lindsay. In April 2022, when Lindsay passed, the outpouring of love and support was beyond belief, and the tribute that we established in her memory at London's Royal Trinity Hospice raised record sums of philanthropy. So I was being human, which helped me cope and therefore helped me care. But two other things transpired that were a bit more surprising. For one, my colleagues and partners stepped up, in a big way. Not only did our client service not suffer, but it was enhanced. As I stepped back, it created the space for my colleagues to play more important leadership roles in our work. They got unparalleled experience with some of our most important assignments, and in doing so, accelerated their professional development, which led to enhanced satisfaction. I came to realize that my long-standing prior commitment to own the assignments I was leading was unintentionally blocking the opportunities for other partners and colleagues to shine. During the year of treatment, I openly told my clients that I would do my very best to add value to the process, but that Alexis or Colin or Kate or Jason would be in the lead. Clients embraced this, as did all of my colleagues, who delivered and grew as top CEO search and succession experts and leadership advisors. Third, as a consequence of this dynamic, and to my genuine shock, our CEO practice had a record year, growing 55% from the prior year, which had also been a record. I experienced this on a personal and individual basis as well, achieving record commercial results. How could all of this happen? By shifting my mindset and letting go of all the mind traps that had unknowingly held me back. By being real and true and honest. By not trying to do it all or be perfect. By creating the space for others to thrive. And today, and moving into the future, it offers a true gift. With my freed up capacity, I now have a more open road to pursue my aspiration, which, like Hortense's, is to help as many others as I can achieve their ultimate professional and personal satisfaction. Going forward, I hope to continue to be the very embodiment of the unlocked leader. Enjoy! Jim Citrin, leader, Spencer Stewart's CEO practice, best-selling author of You're in Charge, Now What? The Five Patterns of Extraordinary Careers, The Dynamic Path, and Leading at a Distance. No one cares how much you know until they know how much you care. Theodore Roosevelt. Introduction: The Fear of Being Human. Imagine an elegant office somewhere in the Upper East Side of New York City. One after the other, top business executives discreetly slip into the comfortable waiting room a few minutes before the door opens. They fear crossing paths with someone they might know. When that happens, both people awkwardly look the other way. This is the office of a renowned psychotherapist, and most of the business leaders who turn up there would rather keep their visits secret. Never mind that over 1 in 5 CEOs now seek therapy. Even Richard Nixon's psychotherapist pointed out that leaders who seek help in times of stress are courageous and serve interests broader than their own. Unfortunately, For many business leaders, openly asking for help and exploring their emotions is still too often perceived as a weakness. For decades, the traditional view was that to be successful, business leaders had to be infallible, unflappable, in control, and fearless. These leaders appeared to be born leaders, naturally endowed with supreme intelligence, coming up with brilliant ideas and directives from the mountaintop that lower echelons were then expected to execute. They're what I call superhero leaders. As an executive coach, I have worked with many such superhero leaders. These smart, goal-oriented, and successful executives are masters at leading with their heads. Yet there is something many of them are now realizing they should probably know, but don't. How to lead with their hearts and souls, too. Hiding behind their superhero leader facade, they're not sure how they can connect differently with people at work. They don't know how to be vulnerable, authentic, and empathetic in a way that unleashes the best in others. In short, they don't know how to be human leaders. This is a problem of global proportions for these leaders themselves, but also for people around them, their companies, and by extension, for the world at large. Why? Because the multiple global challenges and crises we're facing have highlighted that superhero leaders are no longer what companies need. This traditional approach to leadership is not what is most effective today because the world has changed, and so have employees' expectations. A new business environment and new expectations. The world, and therefore the business environment, has become increasingly more volatile, complex, and unpredictable. In 2019, for example, few people would have predicted that a new coronavirus was about to sweep through the world with devastating consequences. We're facing an unprecedented combination of complex socioeconomic, geopolitical, and climate challenges. To survive, companies must be increasingly fast and agile, and expect the unexpected. In the 1920s, a company listed in the S&P 500 could expect to live for 67 years on average. And today, only 15 years. By some estimates, 3/4 of today's S&P 500 companies will be replaced by new firms within 10 years. More than ever, companies must be environments of collaboration, flexibility, and innovation to survive and thrive. In today's business world, no one is infallible, and no single person, no matter how smart and experienced, has all the answers. In addition to navigating a fast-changing and unpredictable environment, business leaders must also address new expectations and needs, starting with employees and increasingly shareholders. To give the best of themselves, employees want to feel respected, listened to, and inspired. They want to be seen, understood, and valued for who they are as individuals. Employees ponder over not only when, where, and how they want to work, but also why they work. Perhaps you think that these are soft, nice-to-have considerations rather than real business imperatives. But failing to pay attention carries a cost that may feel invisible, but directly affects employees' loyalty and engagement, and therefore the company's bottom line. Employees rank respect from their leaders as the consideration that affects their engagement and commitment the most, ahead of recognition or appreciation, an inspiring vision, and opportunities for learning, growth, and development. Yet in March 2022, 3 in 4 employees felt that their company didn't care about their well-being. Companies around the world suffer from an epidemic of disengagement. In addition to being respected, seen, and valued, employees also seek leaders who feel human, not distant and perfect beings with whom they can't connect. There is clear evidence that members of a group consider their leaders as the individuals who put the collective interest before their own, work hard to make other people's good ideas happen, and are strongly perceived as one of us, rather than someone striving to stand out from their peers. In other words, team members who are more concerned with getting things done than having their own way are the ones who emerge as genuine leaders. Why? Because they have more influence on the group than people who think of themselves as leaders and display the dominant behavior traditionally associated with it. In a context of changing expectations from employees and shareholders, as well as the demands of today's business environment, the traditional model of the seemingly unflappable, infallible, and fearless superhero leader doesn't feel like a great match. "We don't need another hero," Tina Turner was already singing in 1985. "We need leaders who want to be a lot more like Coach Ted Lasso of the Apple TV original series, the unassuming Midwestern football coach who transforms a struggling and fractious British Premier League club by bringing hope, joy, and kindness, and an indomitable team spirit." The most effective leadership today, at all levels, from the C-suite to small teams at the bottom of the corporate pyramid, isn't about technical expertise and having all the answers. In addition to articulating a compelling vision, it's about the ability to connect with people, understand their needs, and unleash their potential. As Mary Barra, the CEO of General Motors, put it, "At the end of the day, all businesses are about people first, because the only way we can build genuinely successful businesses is to build lasting relationships inside and outside the company." She told fresh graduates at the Stanford Graduate School of Business, "We do that by holding ourselves accountable, by doing what we say we are going to do, and by inspiring others to strive for something bigger than themselves." Rita McGrath, a business professor at Columbia University, sees the evolution of business management in three eras. The first two were the eras of execution and expertise. Today, she says, management has entered a new era of empathy. Empathy is not often a word that comes to mind when thinking about business strategy and performance. It isn't often the first thing that comes to mind when thinking about successful business leaders, either. But a growing number of companies and business leaders are indeed realizing that the ability to put ourselves in someone else's shoes, whether a colleague, a customer, a supplier, a competitor, or a shareholder, and see the world the way they do, has become a business imperative. Take Microsoft. In 2014, the company was losing ground. The tech giant, whose culture back then was known as brash and aggressive, had missed several fundamental technology shifts toward cloud and mobile computing. Then came a reboot. Over the following years, the company's fortunes turned, pushing the stock price up. Central to Microsoft's success has been a cultural revolution led by Microsoft's new CEO, Satya Nadella. What was that cultural revolution? Embracing empathy. Empathy increasingly appears in job listings from mainstream employers such as strategy consulting firms, banks, or tech firms. Understanding customers' needs, including the needs they might not articulate, is central to innovation and customer service. Microsoft's model coach care approach to management, model the behavior you'd like your reports to embrace, coach them, and care about them and what matters to them as individuals, relies on human connections, too. And the most effective teams are those made up of people of different backgrounds, experience, and perspectives who are able to understand, respect, and trust each other. Empathy is therefore critical at all echelons, starting at the top. In short, to be most effective in today's environment, leaders must be human leaders. Yet despite countless success stories and hard evidence advocating for leadership based on empathy, many leaders still cling to the good old superhero leadership approach. So why do human leaders seem to remain the exception rather than the norm? Because, as the saying goes, the longest journey we'll ever travel is the 18 inches between our head and our heart. Shifting from superhero leader to a more human approach is hard for several reasons. First, we are creatures of habit, relying on what we know. And many leaders have built their success on being goal-focused. Over time, the specific brain network that focuses on setting and achieving goals has grown very robust. The tricky part is, when this specific network in our brain gets activated, the people-focused network, which helps you understand and connect with people's emotions, gets weaker. Effective leaders need to be strong in both, but few are. So for leaders who for years have been so focused on goals, rebalancing their leadership approach takes effort and time. Because they've done well, why invest this time and effort? It's tempting and comfortable to keep doing the same thing. Leadership coach Marshall Goldsmith, for example, might have chosen that path were it not for a conversation with a mentor, which he says changed his life. "You're too good at what you do," his mentor told him. "You're repeating the same day over and over again, and you're very successful. You will have a good life if you keep doing this, but you will never be the person you could be." Marshall realized that his mentor was right and learned a valuable lesson, which he's been sharing with the very successful leaders he coaches. It's easy to think about the importance of unlocking your potential when things are going poorly, he says today. But it's also good to think of this unlocking when things are going well and you're not under pressure. Because the temptation is, I'll write this book someday, or I'll do this research someday. But someday never gets here. There is a second reason why becoming a human leader is not easy. Seemingly fearless superhero leaders striving to become human leaders are facing one sizable obstacle, whether they realize it or not: their own fear. The sum of all fears. When thinking about human leadership, many executives who spent their careers striving to be superhero leaders feel like the ground under their feet is no longer solid. "I was educated and trained to never show my feelings and vulnerability at work," one CEO recently told me. "Now you're telling me I have to? This is a real revolution." Their fear typically manifests in three ways. The fear of connecting with their own emotions. For rational leaders used to flexing their analytical side, looking deep within themselves can feel intimidating, even dangerous. What are they going to find? Self-exploration might upset the apple cart. Even more frightening, exposing their true selves might change how others see them. What if they appear weak? What if they lose control, authority, respect, and love? Frank, the CEO of a very successful startup, reminded me of Forrest Gump, who in the movie of the same name kept running for no particular reason. Frank was working nonstop, juggling multiple projects and flying from meeting to meeting without taking a minute to reflect. At the same time, he struggled to properly communicate his ideas and to inspire his team, which left him frustrated and feeling alone. "Where are you running to?" I asked him. He didn't know. What he was running from soon became clear, however. He was afraid to look at his own emotions. A few months earlier, a close friend had died very suddenly. Frank was not only devastated, he also felt guilty. Guilty that he was still alive, and guilty that he had not done more for his friend. So, he had to run to try to escape these difficult feelings. The fear of chaos. Many leaders believe that if everyone starts relating to their colleagues on a more personal level, it might unleash a tsunami of group hugs and kumbayas, which will detract from actual work. "Emotions do not belong in the office," one senior executive told me. "How will they steer the ship if their role is no longer to fix all problems? What will happen when they let go of control? That thought leaves many of my clients feeling like trapeze artists without a safety net. During the worst of the COVID-19 pandemic, for instance, Bruce, a senior executive in a multinational company, was afraid that making space for emotions might open an uncontrollable floodgate of tears and grief. Where would it stop, he wondered, and what good would it do? Emotions would take over, bring everyone down, and undermine the work they all had to do. He also feared that if he stopped fixing problems himself and instead focused on supporting people and bringing them together so they could find their own solutions, the business would unravel. Someone on his team aptly described him as a soccer coach who kept running on the pitch to play the ball. The fear of failing. Many leaders feel they don't know how to handle emotions at work, their own or others. What if someone on my team tells me they've just lost a parent or a spouse to COVID? A client asked me. Or if someone starts crying, I have no idea what to do or what to say. Effectively leading with heart and soul takes skills and approaches leaders used to wielding their logic and analytical brain power may not have mastered yet. Even worse, these leaders who are used to success fear they could fail spectacularly. I've been successful leading the old way, an executive told me. I like the idea of becoming this new type of leader, but can I be as successful? To many of us, the fear of failing is an old companion. Who has never felt a knot in the pit of their stomach before an important exam? Or when taking on new responsibilities at work? Raise your hand if any of these fears, fear of connecting with our own emotions, fear of chaos, fear of failing, sound familiar. Where do these fears come from? And how can we change in spite of them? Although much is being said about why cultivating empathy and being a human leader is a good idea, very little is on offer when it comes to how. This leaves many leaders locked in their old approach. How to become a human leader. This dearth of how-to reminds me of a dream I had many years ago. I dreamed of my grandmother, who had died years earlier. "Go walk on the path of roses," she told me. The path of roses? I had no idea what she was talking about, but it sounded nice. My grandmother used to love roses, which she grew in her garden with great care and affection. From her perspective, a path of roses could only mean a sacred road to fulfillment, beauty, and happiness. "Where is it?" I asked her in my dream. "You already know where it is," she replied, smiling. "Now go." Then I woke up, furious and anxious. Back then I was feeling stuck. My life was filled with people who believed that to be successful, they were supposed to be superhero leaders. After years working in advertising and communications, I felt like I would have to fit into that leadership mold for my career to progress. That mold did not feel like me, but I feared I would fail if I veered from the successful and familiar path I was on, even though it was not working for me. Where was the exit? How could I find that path of roses? Although my dream suggested, I already knew what to do and where to go. I didn't have the faintest idea. Yet, once I overcame my fear of change, I became an entrepreneur, leading teams of engineers in a sector I knew nothing about. There was no technical expertise I could contribute, so I was free to focus my energy on articulating an inspiring vision, as well as on motivating, supporting, and creating an environment in which everyone could deploy their unique talents, learn and grow, and become the best version of themselves. I finally felt at home. Finding my own path to a different kind of leadership convinced me to help others find theirs. So how can you become an effective human leader? This is what this book is about. It offers a roadmap to your own path of roses. I have developed this roadmap based on my own journey, as well as my exploration of neuroscience, psychology, and spirituality, and years of coaching successful executives and entrepreneurs to become even more effective by leading differently. Although this book focuses on leadership at work, each of us is a complete individual, not a sum of separate, isolated parts. As such, the process presented in this book applies to all areas of your life. The journey from superhero leader to human leader is one of deep inner transformation, because genuine and authentic empathy comes from within. It isn't about applying a few tricks and parroting the right words, which comes across as neither genuine nor authentic. To be able to profoundly understand and connect with others, we must first understand and connect with who we are and step into the fuller, truer version of ourselves. To do so, we must remove old beliefs and expectations that no longer serve us, what I call mind traps. Part 1 will help you understand and identify these invisible mind traps that hold you back from changing how you lead. Part 2 describes the process I use to help my clients create a mind shift to move past their mind traps. Finally, Part 3 is about mind build, how you can build and anchor a new perspective and new practices that unlock the human leader within you. In this book, the journey from mind trap to mind shift and mind build is presented in a sequential and linear fashion, to the extent possible. In reality, this journey typically isn't that perfectly sequential and linear, just like the Earth isn't flat, even though it is often presented as a two-dimensional map. Throughout this book, you'll find many companions traveling by your side. Some are main characters whose stories run like threads across chapters. Others play supporting roles, appearing only to illustrate specific points. Also keeping you company is an imaginary child who's looking for his path of roses. His fable opens each chapter. Besides, hopefully, making this book enjoyable, these stories are meant to deepen your transformation. Although facts and research will speak to the analytical and linear circuits in your brain, often known as your left brain, these stories are meant to activate your more intuitive, emotional right brain. I also hope that you will recognize part of yourself in these stories and that they'll encourage, inspire, and support you throughout your journey toward human leadership. My purpose with this book is for you to know what took me years to realize: that my grandmother was right. The key to unlocking that fuller, truer version of ourselves lies within us, and this book is to help you find it, so you can lead with empathy and shine your light in the world. Part 1. Mind Trap. Identify your lock. To become human leaders, we must be able to lead not only with our heads, but also with our hearts and souls. Cultivating empathy starts with ourselves. To connect and to understand other people's perspectives and emotions, we must first connect to and understand our own. Over time, we have formed beliefs and perspectives that shape our view of ourselves, others, and the world. Our journey toward becoming a human leader requires identifying which among these beliefs and perspectives have become obstacles to leading with empathy, our mind traps. Part 1 is about understanding how mind traps are born, Chapter 1, how to identify our own, Chapter 2, and uncover what and who hides behind them, Chapter 3. Chapter 1. When the keys to past success get in your way. How mindsets become mind traps. Once upon a time, there was a child who lived by the sea. He spent time sitting on a rock, drawing circles in the sand with a stick. Each day, the tide would cover the circles, and each day, the child would draw the same circles. "Hello, my friend," the child hears one day. The child looks around, but no one else is there. "Down here," the boy says. The child sees an oyster clinging to a rock. "Are you an oyster like me?" the oyster asks. "Can't you see I'm a human?"
"You don't feel like a human," the oyster says.
"All humans are gifted beyond measure. They can move mountains and travel the sea. They can dream and make the impossible possible. Do you ever dream of what lies beyond these shores?" The child has never thought about it.
"Then your gift is locked inside your shell, just like my pearl."
"Humans can make the impossible possible?" The thought makes the child's heart sing. "How do I unlock my human gift?" the child asks the oyster.
"I don't know," the oyster says.
"I'm not human." They are both silent for a moment. A fisherman walks by. "Here is a human who's traveled to other shores," the child thinks. "Perhaps he can help."
"Do you know how I can unlock my human gift?"
the child asks the fisherman after greeting him.
"Look for the path of roses," the fisherman says.
The child has heard of that path of roses. People in the village talk about it sometimes.
"How do I find it?"
"That's for you to figure out," the fisherman says. "But you won't find it if you stay here."
Although the idea of leaving his village scares him a little, the child decides to go look for the path of roses and unlock his human gift. So he says his goodbyes and walks away from his village with a heart full of hope, but also trepidation about the journey ahead. Before reaching the forest, the child comes across a horse in a meadow. The horse is walking around in a circle, sniffing the grass, which is dry and patchy. The horse's ribs are showing through its dull coat, which is taut as a drum.
"Are you okay?" the child asks.
"I'm hungry," says the horse. "I don't know what's happened to my grass. It used to be green and thick, and I was happy here, but now it's all dried up, and I cannot find enough to eat."
Looking a bit further out, the child sees a green meadow.
"Why don't you move to that meadow over there?"
For the first time, the horse looks up.
"I had not seen that meadow before. The grass indeed looks thick and green over there," the horse says. "But I cannot go."
"Why not?" the child asks.
"Because of the electric fence," the horse says. "It will hurt me if I try to go over there."
"What fence?" the child asks, perplexed. "I don't see any fence."
"I grew up in this meadow, and I know it's here," the horse says. "The farmer put it up when I was little to keep the cows out, so they wouldn't walk to my meadow and eat all my grass. That's how I was able to grow big and strong. But every time I walk too close to the edge, it gave me a big jolt. I can still feel it, so I'm not going anywhere."
How strange, the child thinks. The horse is locked inside an invisible prison. As he walks away, the child then wonders, is he too trapped within invisible fences? How do the beliefs and outlook that get shaped in our brain over time become obstacles that stand in our way? In other words, how do mindsets turn into mind traps? And why is it so difficult to see them in ourselves? This chapter will explain the following: how mind traps get created, how we can tell that a mind trap is standing in our way, why we don't see ourselves as clearly as we think. The birth of a mind trap. From an early age, Harry, the CEO of a Fortune 500 company, strove to be perfect. At school, teachers saw mistakes as weaknesses to be eradicated rather than opportunities to learn. At home, Harry's mother expected him to excel in everything he did, pushing him to fulfill the limitless potential she saw in him. Harry concluded that striving for perfect grades and number one rankings would lead to elite universities. Elite universities would in turn pave the way to prestigious employers, where a perfect performance would be the ticket to a high-flying career. In short, striving for perfection was the road to success. This perfectionist mindset
served Harry well. It motivated him to excel, and excel he did. By age 30, he'd made partner at a top strategy consulting firm. From his perspective, everything was going swimmingly. Then he went through a 360 assessment. Although he scored very well on many dimensions, his team's engagement ranked lower than the firm's average. Harry was shocked. How could that be? He didn't know what to do with that feedback, so he ignored it. A few years later, after he'd become a senior executive in another company, another assessment again revealed that his team was not as motivated as the rest of the company. Again, Harry met the feedback with disbelief. The company was doing significantly better than a few years earlier, which suggested he was doing everything right. And if the problem was not with him, then it had to be with his team. Harry hadn't yet realized that his relentless pursuit of perfection in himself and others meant that he often viewed others as obstacles rather than partners. His mindset and behavior hampered human relationships and, by extension, effective teamwork and collaboration. A belief that had served him so well had become a limitation on his path to become a better leader. His mindset had become a mind trap. Many of the beliefs, mindsets, or other perspectives that our brains concoct are meant to serve us well. In fact, this is precisely why they take shape in the first place. Initially, these beliefs earn us approval, love, admiration, or acceptance. Who doesn't want all that? These instinctive pulls are almost impossible to resist, particularly at a young age, and they influence our behavior and our choices. Children instinctively strive for their parents' love and protection because it is vital for their survival and proper physical, psychological, and emotional development. As we grow up, we typically want to feel that we belong to a group of like-minded friends or allies who provide protection, collaboration, and understanding. Many teenagers desperately want to conform to whatever tribe they choose. In high school, my client Tanisha, a senior executive, badly felt the need to belong and make friends with popular girls and have fun. Yet earning that acceptance and becoming part of that group was incompatible with being a good student, which wasn't considered cool. But Tanisha wanted and needed to excel at school. To square that circle, she learned to show only part of herself. To her teachers and parents, she was the smart and successful student. And to her friends, she carefully hid her good grades and drive to learn so she could be the cool, friendly, and funny girl who, like them, felt that school was lame and good students, hopeless nerds. Only when she graduated top of her class did her friends discover that she'd been one of these nerds all along. This instinctive need to belong extends far beyond family, friends, and colleagues. Our often unconscious quest to fit in results in our absorbing collective beliefs and worldviews, such as social, cultural, national, or religious norms. Like the air we breathe, these norms are all around us, and they rule many aspects of our lives, from gender or family roles to work behavior. Whether we want it or not, they shape us by influencing our view of how we are supposed to behave or what it means to be a good friend, neighbor, parent, colleague, or leader. Star athletes like Olympic swimmer Michael Phelps and NBA player Kevin Love, for example, have said how social values about men in general, and male athletes in particular, have influenced their behavior. For the longest time, I thought asking for help was a sign of weakness, because that's kind of what society teaches us, Phelps says. That's especially true from an athlete's perspective. If we ask for help, then we're not this big macho athlete that people can look up to. Love echoed the same sentiment. Growing up, you figure out really quick how a boy is supposed to act, he said. You learn what it takes to be a man. It's like a playbook. Be strong. Don't talk about your feelings. Get through it on your own. So, for 29 years of my life, I followed that playbook. These collective norms determine how many leaders view their role and how they should behave. They also influence how we define success or failure, or even happiness. So, on the one hand, these mindsets we adopt are useful. They bring us love, recognition, a sense of belonging or the drive to succeed, among many other things. On the other hand, they can also bind us. The problem arises when our mind behaves like the horse in the fable at the beginning of this chapter. We, too, can get stuck, bound by invisible fences of our own making that prevent us from moving forward. This is when a mindset becomes a mind trap. Why does it happen? How can something that initially helps us become an obstacle? Whether suddenly or slowly, in big or small ways, everything and everyone changes. Ourselves, others, and our environment. We become older. We change jobs. A new colleague joins our team. A pandemic spreads across the world. Someone becomes sick or dies. Children are born, grow up, and make their own lives. Yet, the mental constructions that live largely in our unconscious do not always adjust. We keep thinking and behaving in the same way, or we cannot let go of old emotions. This is how mindsets that have outlived their purpose become mind traps. What once served you no longer does. I'm good at this, or this is how I've always done it, turns into it no longer works. Patrick, a senior executive in the insurance industry, was a math whiz who had built a successful career on his technical expertise, which propelled him from promotion to promotion. He spent his free time solving math problems and approached most challenges as equations to be solved. He was now being considered to head one of the group's subsidiaries, which involved interacting with the board of directors and the media. The CEO of the group was hesitating, however, wondering whether Patrick had the emotional intelligence that the new position required. Although he was impeccably charming and polite, he was also distant, keeping all interactions with his colleagues and his team strictly about work, and carefully avoiding any whiff of conversation that might veer toward the personal. He managed his team as a group of variables to be organized in the right order to play their part, and saw no need.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.